So what I have been studying so far is how to avoid spill response. And we have described two different points of view, which are of course equivalent. One is intuitive picture. So the intuitive picture is what we had started with, namely we integrate omega n, where n are the 6t minus 6 plus 2n plus 2n over the subspace of PGA. So, okay, this is the standard viewpoint we have taken for bosonic scattering theory as well as for superstrings. The problem with this viewpoint is that this subspace typically intersects locus of spurious poles. And because of this, strictly speaking, this integral is indefinite because you are passing through the spurious poles. I will describe a way to define the integral despite this difficulty. And that was to use vertical integration rules. Use vertical integration rules, which basically means that we use relations of this following type. Okay, so even if this line passes through a spurious pole, you use this fact that because it's a total derivative, the difference involves only the initial and the final point. And as long as this relation function involving this is non-singular, it doesn't matter that on the way this z will pass through a spurious pole. So this is intuitive, okay, because this is strictly not defined, we are passing through a singular. Nevertheless, this intuitive idea notion is very useful because we can apply Stokes' theorem based on this idea. Namely, if you have two different subspaces of PGM on which you are integrating, then the difference between the integrals over these two different subspaces can be written as integral of t omega n over the region that is bounded by the subspace. And then you use the fact that the integral d omega n is omega n plus 1, but evaluated with qb acting on its arguments. Okay, and then that leads to various identities that we can have. Okay, exactly as in the case of bosonic scattering. But we can make this into a more rigorous picture by what we have M here. Okay, so a rigorous picture. This is what with pullback of omega n on MGM using the section. Okay, this pullback is defined, of course, using a section. Okay, and then using that, you can give it a form, n form on PGMN, you can define an n form on NGMN, and then you can integrate it on NGMN. But this, of course, works for piecewise continuous sections. So the general picture will be the following. So let's suppose this is your NGMN. we basically divide it into regions. Later on, we will discuss the more systematic way of considering the regions. Well, let's suppose that we split it into many regions. And let's call them M1, M2, M3, etc. So on each M alpha, on each of these regions M alpha, choose a section such that there are no spurious poles. Okay, then you just on each of these M alphas, you choose your picture changing off part locations so that you don't go near a spurious pole. You do this for every one of these M alphas, and then at the boundary between two M alphas, you give what is the job. Okay, that's how you choose the section. But instead of thinking of this as an integral around that vertical section, you just rewrite this as an integral over the boundaries. Okay, because you are basically, so if you look at the picture in BGMN, what is happening is that if this is MGMN and this is PGMN, okay, I am going to draw a one dimensional picture. So there are various jumps like this. Okay, so these are the piecewise continuous sections, and because in the boundary between two sections, you make a jump. Okay, PCO locations are no longer continuous. So that means that when you project down this integration over MGN, whenever there is a boundary between two such regions, you have to add a correction term which corresponds to integrating omega along this vertical direction. Okay, those are the correction terms you have to add. And typically they will, so if M alpha beta or beta is the boundary, between M alpha and M beta, we have to add a correction term of the form integral over M alpha beta of some N minus 1. Taking for its mu alpha beta of n minus 1. Okay, this is an n minus 1. I'll describe shortly how to concept this. So mu n minus 1 is integral over the vertical segment of omega n. Okay, along the vertical segment, the picture changing operators jump. Okay, and so you integrate around the vertical segment, that is one dimensional vertical segment. You integrate over the vertical segment, this omega n. So basically you are supposed to integrate omega n over this whole vertical segment, which has of course this direction as well as some base direction, which is one, which is four dimensional one. Okay, or total n minus one, that's these boundaries. You carry out a vertical integration first and reinterpret this as some kind of n minus 1 form that have to integrate over this boundary. That's the idea. Is this picture clear? Okay, that we are basically here it looks like one dimensional, but actually one dimensional is only vertical direction. Then in the horizontal direction, the section of course is more complicated. We first do the integral around the vertical direction, and that produces an n minus 1 form, because one integral has already been done. That n minus 1 form now has to be integrated over the boundary
that separate this.
The omega sum is this omega bar c that you are referring.
Yeah, I think I call this called omega bar c. Yeah, and then write down the more specific formula for mu n minus 1. So let me write this mu n minus 1. The more explicit. Yeah, I'll call this q alpha beta of omega n. So what is q alpha beta? So this is a path from ECO configuration in M alpha to ECO configuration in M beta. So suppose there are k PCOs. Consider the case of k PCO. And suppose in M alpha, we denote the k PCO by z1 alpha, z2 alpha, z3 alpha. And on M beta, similarly it's so to do the vertical integration, to do the integration over that vertical segment, you have to define what a vertical segment is. If there is only one piece, then it was simple. You just take the segment from z1 alpha to z1 beta. Then for k equal to 1, it's simple. Just move from z1 alpha to z1 beta. But in general, you have to specify a path. Okay? Which one you move first? Okay? So you can move this first, or this first, or this first. Okay? In the different orders you can move. So let's consider a specific example. Example. Move z1, then z2, then z3 and so on. Okay, later on I'll try to give a more geometric way to represent this moves. Okay, but for now, yes, we first move z1, so that means first change z1 alpha to z1 beta, then we take z2 alpha to z2 beta and so on. Okay, so that the path is a sum of segments. On each segment, only one segment. Then mu alpha beta n minus 1. So let me write down the expression for omega n that I am doing, or omega p in general.
There are k factorial set paths?
There are basically 2 to the k such paths actually. Because at each stage, so maybe k factor. Yeah, you have to specify the order. Yeah, so there are k factor as such parts. Right? You have to order which one moves first. Okay, so omega p. Okay, let me write down the expression for omega p again. Okay, so the conventions are here. So this is given by product over alpha equal to 1 to k, chi of the alpha. I of the I minus n psi I times O. Okay. O involves the product of one of these Vx's and the product of the I's. Okay, so I'll not write them down explicitly again. There are arbitrary number of these. Okay, this is a formal sum of arbitrary number of arbitrary forms. Okay, so you can start with just product of Yeah, which will be 0 form, then one factor of dx dx is times product over ixi, then two factors product over ixi and so on. So O is the formal sum of all of these. And then the idea is that you take this whole product, expand it out and pick the p form part of this product. Right? That's omega. So now let's calculate this. So this is integral over q alpha beta of omega n. So in the first step, when you move z1, you pick up a factor of xi of z1 alpha minus xi of z1 alpha. Okay, that comes from, because when you are moving z1, you have to pick this term. Okay, z1, so z1 is gone. And then we have do that tie equal to 2 to k tie of z I 1. Let's try to see if we agree with this. So your z1 integral has been picked up. Okay? There is no further factors of z1 anywhere. Now, when you are moving z1 to z1 alpha to z1 beta, because you are moving this first, rest of the z's are still z alphas. Right? Because when you are moving this, the rest of the z's are still z alphas. So that's why I have used it. Sorry, Zeta is alpha. Okay? And because you are considering this as a form on A, of course you have to pull it back. Okay, this is a form on P GMN, but you always have to pull back this onto M GMN. Is this clear? Because these Zeta alphas, let's look at the picture. So suppose in MGMN, this is MGMN, we have two such regions are intersecting, right? Let's imagine that we have a boundary, M alpha, M. So on this boundary, of course all the other Z2s can vary, Z2, Z3, Z4, these can vary, right? So in general, you know how they vary, because section is given. Okay, how z2 varies, z3 varies, okay, but these are all the variations in the alpha region, okay, m alpha. So knowing this, we just pull it back onto a form on m here, okay, on the base. Okay, so in other words, if z alpha is given as a function of the base coordinates, you just use that to reinterpret this as a function of the base coordinates and reinterpret this dzi alpha as some form on the base coordinates. Okay, that's how you pull it back, right? Pull back basically means that you have to re-express all coordinates on the on PGMN in terms of coordinates on MGMN. Is this clear? So this is the first step. Okay, so let me write the later terms and then we will come back to this again. So next there will be xi of z2 minus xi of z2. Okay, this is the segment in which z2 moves from alpha to beta, and now inside we have the first term which is chi of z two alpha minus n xi. Thank you. So what I have done here, this is the integral, okay, over the segment in which z2 is moving. Right? So z2 is changing from z2 alpha to z2 beta. Right? That produces this I of z2 alpha minus I of z2 beta because of this minus sign. Now inside, this is being done after you have moved z1 alpha to z1 beta. Right? So z1 now is fixed at z1 beta. Okay? That's why here we are using z1 beta. Is clear? Because z1 has already moved. But all the other z's from I equal to 3 to k are still z1, z alpha. Then because when z2 is moving from z2 alpha to z2 beta, okay, z1 has already been got moved to z1 beta. And others are fixed at z1 alpha. So this point here. Okay, maybe I can draw this figure that I drew last time. Okay. Consider this k equal to 2. So it's symmetrically represent this. So this is our z alpha 1, z alpha 2. Okay. This is z alpha z beta 1, z alpha 2. This is z alpha 1. Beta 2. And this is the alpha beta 1. Remember that 1 and 2 refers to the two PCOs. Alpha and beta refer to the two sections. Okay. In region alpha, we have chosen one PCO, one PCO arrangement. In region beta, we have chosen another PCO. So the path that we are following here is that we first move Z1. Go like this. Right? So along this path, z2 is the same as z1. Okay? That's why in this product, okay, a is 2 here, so that will be 1 term. So this is fixed at z1. Along this path, z2 is changing from z2 alpha to z2 beta, but z1 is fixed at z1 beta. Right? Because z1 is fixed at z1 beta, here I have written chi of z1 beta minus delta z1 beta dz1 beta. And then here, okay, this of course is not there. Okay. Is this point clear? Yeah, so this one, for each segment, you pick the corresponding term, okay, integrate, and that gives you mu alpha beta n minus 1. Okay, this is the n minus 1 form that we have taken here. And this, by construction, is completely free from any spurious poles. Because this doesn't know about the path over which you are integrating, right? Because this only involves the differences between the two initial and the final points, which you have assumed to be free from spurious poles. Okay? All the corner points we are assuming are free from spurious poles.
This mu alpha beta n minus 1, this should be independent of which order I take.
No, this is not independent of which order you take. Right. So there is an ambiguity. Right? So you could choose this path. You could choose this path. Right? In PGMN, this means that you are filling up the, you are choosing two different sections. Right? Offshell amplitudes will depend on how you choose a section, right?
Yeah,
onshell amplitudes. Okay, we give the same proof, right? The Stokes theorem. Applying Stokes theorem, what we construct is the onshell amplitudes, okay, under two different choice of sections, differ by total length. Yeah, and then you have to ensure that the total length is perfect and all. So in MGMN, it's not absolutely straightforward to see that these two are the same. Okay, that these two differ by total length. Well, you can prove it. Okay. So if you construct mu alpha beta n minus 1 and say mu prime alpha beta n minus 1, where mu prime corresponds to going this way, we have two different expressions on MGMN. Okay. Their difference, okay, you can manipulate in principle. But if you think of these as descending from two different subspaces of PGMN, then it becomes clear that by using Stokes' theorem, okay, and the various identities that omega p satisfies, the difference between integrating on two different subspaces in PGMA becomes total derivative when you are talking about all shape equations. Is this point clear? Right? Because we gave the proof, right? Earlier. So difference between two integrations over two different sections. So is this clear? So you have to add correction term at the boundary between two regions in MGM. Right? When you divide up MGM into multiple regions, okay, on each you choose a PCO's arbitrarily, but let the PCO jump as you go from one to the other. We have to add correction terms on the boundaries. Okay, and let me repeat again that these different choice of paths, okay, will give you two different choice for mu alpha beta n minus 1. But that is at the same level of ambiguity as we had for different choice of sections in PGM. Now, before we proceed, okay, let me give a generalization of this picture. That here you are considering k equal to 2, okay, but for general k, okay, the k is yours. There is a useful way to represent these various choice of paths. Okay, and that's what we want to describe. So consider a lattice of integers not. Okay, k real dimensional space. So this is basically k dimensional integer lattice. Okay, cubic. Then represent z alpha 1 to z alpha k by the origin 0 to the k. Okay, so 0 to the k basically means that all coordinates are 0. Okay, that's one point in this integer lattice. Similarly, represent z beta 1 to z beta 3 by 1 to 3. This is equivalent to all integers in 1. Okay, so you think of it as a unit cube. This one is representing the origin, this one is representing the opposite vortex. Now, a path of the kind that we are interested in will correspond to moving each z only one z at a time. Okay. So, in this cubic lattice, okay, generalizing this, a path will be a collection of links, okay, so that their sum, that initial point is the origin, the final point is 1. Right? It's a collection of things.
So,
which lattice are k-dimensional lattice? Hypertrophic lattice. K-dimensional lattice, right? So, a path will correspond to moving from 0 to 1, from 0 to the k to 1 to the k, along some links of the lattice. Is this clear? You don't travel diagonally, for example. Right? You don't travel diagonally like this. So, every segment of a path will correspond to only one coordinate. And the different choices of paths will correspond to these different ways of drawing, going from 0 to 1, okay, by along the lengths. Right? For example, if you have a cube, you could first move k in z1, then z2, then z3. okay, or for z2, then z1, then z3, and so on. Okay, these will be all be represented by different collection of names. Okay, so this is a big channel. Keep in mind. So this Q alpha beta that I introduced, Q alpha beta was a path. So Q alpha beta is a collection of lanes. Collection of lanes. So now we will consider a slightly more complicated situation. Well, not a complicated situation, which will arise in any case given in the diagram later on. So imagine that we have a situation where two of these boundaries meet. Okay, so this is my M alpha, this is my M beta, and this is my M alpha. Okay, there are plenty of such points you will find on the diagram. Okay, this is the simplest possibility, 3 lines meet. Okay, in general that can be more than 3 lines meet, meeting. Okay, well, let's consider this situation. Now, when you go from M alpha to M beta, there is a path C alpha beta, Q alpha beta. There is Q alpha beta. Similarly, M beta to M gamma, okay, there is some path Q beta gamma. So these we have. We assume that we have chosen one sample. Okay? Because in order to define mu n minus 1, you have to specify a path. Okay? Specifying a path will correspond to choosing particular section of PGMN. Okay? We assume that we have chosen such particular section of PGMN to define our option amplitude. Okay? So these choices are given to us. Q alpha beta, Q beta gamma, and Q gamma. So let us start from the simplest case, A equal to 1. K equal to 1, this is a one-dimensional integral lattice. Okay. Now we have to generalize our earlier construction slightly. So the origin we will call Z alpha 1. Then the point 1 will correspond to Z beta 1. And then this point will correspond to Z bar. So when you go to M alpha to M beta, you are effectively integrating to construct the corresponding Q, we are integrating omega n along this curve. Right? Yeah, there is no ambiguity, there is only one possible path, it's one dimensional. Similarly, when you go from M beta to M gamma, we are integrating around this part. And from M gamma to M alpha, we are integrating around this part, yeah, which is basically going backwards. Okay, now of course, the only endpoints of the path are important, right? It doesn't matter quite the path which name the path is following. Okay, as long as only one Z varying, right? And here there is only one Z after all, so there is one Z, only one Z can vary.
How do you decide the direction of the path? With some extra term you have to add in the boundary. So how do you decide this way or that way?
Well, that depends on, again, you think of this as the integral over omega n, okay, continuous and oriented surface and omega n. So that will tell us the sign, because basically you are not interested about the sign, right? So again, to determine the sign, it's always useful to think of this as an integral in, on PGMN. Then integral of omega and p 0, and that will fix the sign completely, right? It will, because it fixes orientation. If you are coming like this, then you have to go like this and then go like this. Okay, so here what you see is that there is no gap left over. Right? So if you think of these as surfaces in PGML, okay, so this corresponds to some vertical subspace, right? Over which you are integrating on this. Okay, here there is a vertical subspace, here there is a vertical subspace, but they just fit nicely together. Okay? Because there is no gap between these two and the line that is coming back. Okay, this line that is coming back, you can take, think of this as just going along the this axis back. Okay, again. All that is important is the endpoints. Okay, it doesn't matter which path, I mean the path is not relevant. I've just drawn this, drawn it like this to distinguish it from these two paths. But what is important is that only one set changes at a time. So k equal to 1 is perfectly fine. Now consider k equal to 2. Okay, and we have to generalize this construction. So now we have a two dimensional lattice. But you have to consider now a lattice of length 2. So this point over here is z alpha 1, z alpha 2, z alpha 3. So along this direction, so k is 2. Okay, so 2 dimensional lattice. So and along this direction, this point is z beta 1, z beta 1. And this point is z gamma 1. Okay, and from this you can read out all the other points, right? For example, this one, this is z1 is changing, right? So this is z beta 1, z alpha 2. This is z gamma 1. Here it will be z2 is changing, so z alpha 1, z beta 2. Here z2 is changing to z gamma 1, z beta 2. z2 is changing, so z alpha 1, z gamma 2. Okay, I think you get the idea, right? I mean, you represent all these possible combinations as points on this lattice. Okay, earlier, when we had only m alpha beta, we only have to restrict to this part. Okay, but now we have added a gamma, so we have to now also have beta gamma and alpha gamma 6.
What is the number of this m alphas that you are dividing your base in?
Could be many. We have not said anything about how many m alphas there.
They are
decided. Because this is local, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, whatever analysis you have to do here is local, that when three m's overlap, what happens? Doesn't matter how many other m alphas there are. Then in general, it could be even 2 or 1, right? Or it could be many. What you need is that each m alpha should be sufficiently small so that you can choose the PCOs on that m alpha without fitting spurious superiorities. Okay? And as long as each m alpha is sufficiently small, you can always do that. Okay? Over a small region of the moduli space, you can find z's. Because after all, the PCOs are spurious singularities and four dimension two locals, right? So you can always find over a small, sufficiently small region of the moduli space some choice of PCO locations which are free from spurious singularities. Yeah, so, you assume that we have chosen the alpha to be sufficient response so that can be done. Okay, so now Let's suppose that we chose the path in the way I specified earlier, that first move 1, next move 2. Okay? And you do this for this jump as well as this jump. Okay, you could have chosen some other combination. It didn't have to be the same path, same prescription that you choose over this and this and this. Okay, but that's for definiteness, as well as that's what we have done. So then,
can we give a matrix like representation of this transformation? How does it work?
So you can do that, but the diagrammatic representation is not easy. Okay, it gives you an idea of what's happening. So between alpha and beta, right? So you define your mu n minus 1 alpha beta. You integrate along this path. Right? You can reinterpret this as it has in PGMN. Right? That the vertical section will consist of this segment. Then to go from beta to gamma, you go like this. And then from gamma to alpha, you move 1 for a second. So you go like this and like this. Is this clear? You move 1 for z1 gamma to z1 alpha, and then from z to gamma. So let me introduce the notation. So this line I have called M alpha beta. This line was M beta gamma. This line was M gamma alpha. This point, okay, we will start a point, it's a coordination two subspace. This I will call M alpha beta gamma. Okay, this is coordination two. In M0. Okay, which means it's dimension n minus 2.
That point.
Yeah, what looks like a point here actually is for dimension 2. Okay. The triple intersection. Okay. So this is dimension n minus 2. So now you see what is happening is that if you define the integral this way. On MGMN, everything is fine. But when you reinterpret this in PGMN, okay, what has happened is that you have left a gap. So you are supposed to choose a continuous n dimensional subspace of PGMN on which you integrate. Okay. But what you have done is that you have chosen according to this prescription. But you have left a gap, okay, again n dimensional gap, which is obtained by taking this subspace, two dimensional surface, over this n minus two dimensional subspace over this. Yes, if you consider a region of PGMN that is whose fiber, okay, whose base is this m alpha beta gamma, which is co-dimension 2, dimension n minus 2, and whose fiber is this area. That is a gap that is left over. Okay, that when you do these vertical segments from this side, and this side, okay, they don't quite fit together here. Okay, they leave behind a gap. Okay, which is this surface over the dimension n minus 2, first to same alpha beta gamma. Is this point clear? Yeah. So what is the observation here? That you have this path over here. This path over here, and the return path is not quite the same. Okay. So that means that there is some surface that is left behind. Okay. Now in PGMN, what does it mean? Right? What it means is that for every point in M alpha beta gamma, okay, this particular subspace, okay, is the mismatch, represents a mismatch between the regions that you get from this side and this side. Right? See, each of these give some region of which you are integrating. Right? So this gives you some region of PGMN that you are integrating.
This gives you a region of PGM that you are integrating. This gives you a region of PGM that you are integrating. This gives you some more region of PGM that you are integrating. This is a vertical segment. This gives you some other vertical segment. This gives you some other vertical segment. Right? Each of these are in-dimensional subsets of PGM. Right? Because you are reducing the dimension in MGM, dimension of the base, but at the same time we are adding a vertical dimension. Okay? So each of these are n-dimensional subspaces. What this picture shows is that those n-dimensional subspaces, when you put them together, they don't make a continuous n-dimensional subspace. Okay? There is a gap that is left behind. And that gap is basically this subspace, fiber over this n-2-dimensional subspace, which is this point.
Fiber?
Yeah, because this is a point on the base, right? This gives you some surface in the fiber direction. Right? Because these z directions are fiber, right? Fiber direction. So what is happening is that there is a subspace that is left over, which is in the base is n-2-dimensional. Okay? And in the vertical direction, there is an area which together gives you an n-dimensional subspace. Okay? That is what you have to supply in order to make it into continuous subspace, continuous n-dimensional. Right? It's like if n is 2, right? If you have a 2-dimensional space and there is a hole cut, okay, that when you have put all the pieces together, right? You haven't quite filled the 2-dimensional space, there is a hole in between that is cut out. Okay, and that is the hole you have to fill. Is this point clear? Okay, imagine that n is really 2. Okay, that's what I have been drawing, right? 2-dimensional surface. If n is really 2, then this is of course just really a point, okay. And the hole is in the vertical direction. Okay, when you have put all these subspaces together in the vertical direction, there is a hole which is just this area. Okay, that has not been filled. So you have to add new terms, okay, which involve integral of omega n over this subspace to fill that hole.
So at that point there is, because we are adding this new term, so the contributions at that point are path independent.
Contribution at what?
Contribution at this codimension to this thing.
This point, yes.
That is path independent, right? Because we are adding this extra term.
Well, when you add this, then the whole thing becomes a continuous subspace. I don't know. What exactly do you mean by path independent?
The difference between picked up from various paths, we are adding precisely that term.
Yes, I think that term, so it's not path independent. That path independence is a different story, right? That we are comparing two different sections. See, path independence is just if you integrate over two different subspaces of PGM, right? Because their difference is zero. Okay, that's the meaning of path independence. You are not trying to compare two different subspaces. Okay? We are trying to build one subspace of PGM. Okay, just focus on building a single subspace of PGM and only you integrate and define the optional approach. But the single subspace of PGM has to be continuous, right? Because if you want to apply Stokes' theorem, for example, okay? Or various things, if the subspace is not continuous, it has its own boundary, somewhere in the middle, there is a hole cut out, then of course you will get additional boundary terms from those, right? When you apply various order identities, which you certainly don't want, right? You want this to be a continuous subspace of PGM, you know what you integrate, right? Except that you are now allowing some vertical sections in the subspace. See, this not adding this is as bad as if you are integrating over these, okay, and not adding these. Okay. Why do you have to add this vertical integration? Because otherwise there will be a hole left over. Okay? This section is not continuous. Right? If you just take this plus this, it's not continuous. Okay? To make this into a continuous surface, you have to add integral over this. Okay? What you are saying here is that it is not enough to just add integral over this. Okay? In one dimension it is enough. Right? In this picture it is enough. But in a more general sense, right, when suppose the base is 2-dimensional, okay, it's not just enough to add integral over this, you have to also add at this point the integral over this subspace. Okay, it may be hard to see geometrically because it requires visualizing high dimensional subspaces, right? High dimensional spaces. But the picture should be clear that the very fact that these cars have some 2-dimensional subspace enclosed by them means that these cars are not matching together, they are not fitting together at this junction.
Okay. So whatever is left behind, whatever is being enclosed by these cards, okay, is something that you have to add back.
No, spurious
force will pass even through these.
Yes, sir. No, I'm saying that the particle section.
Yeah, somewhere in the particle section. So forget about spurious poles. Right? Now you are not worried about spurious poles because you know that spurious poles do not appear in the final equation. Right? Now you are only interested in that even avoiding forgetting about spurious poles. Right? If you are integrating over some subspace of PGM, even if there is no spurious pole, right? Unless you have a continuous subspace, you don't get the desired identity. Right? You have to integrate over a continuous subspace of PGM. Right? And what we are saying is that if we don't add this particular vertical section. Right, which is now a two-dimensional particle section. Right? It's based on a four-dimensional two subspace. Earlier, these vertical sections are the base was four-dimensional one, right? And this was a one-dimensional particle segment, right? Because each this particle segment consists of one-dimensional parts joined together. But now what we are saying is that is not enough to make this into a continuous subspace. What we need is to add to whatever you have done earlier, also segments like this, okay, that where you take this subspace and integrate, and basically product of these times this particle segment, this particle section. Is this clear? So this can be translated to adding a parallaxial term to the what you already had. So either you can think of this in PGMN, which means that you integrate omega n over the product of this times this, or you think in MGMN and you add integral of m alpha beta gamma mu n minus 2, where mu n minus 2 is integral over this. So this part I'll now call, what should I call, Q alpha. This is I'll call Q alpha beta gamma. Okay, this two dimensional subspace I'll call Q alpha beta gamma. So just like Q alpha beta was a particle segment, right? Gave a specific path, but a one-dimensional particle segment. This now is a two-dimensional particle segment. Okay, which comes at the answer of 3. So this is integral q alpha beta gamma of omega n. So let's try to work this up. What is it? So you see that on this, 0 and z to a vector, right? So this will be your basically integral q alpha beta gamma. Minus j, minus 2 minus n times. So del z is z1, dz1, which del z is z2, dz2. So all z1, z2 dependence are called gone. So what we are left with is this O of n minus 2. This is n minus 2 form because you have a n form, but you are integrating over a 2 dimensional subspace. And we will have to play in minus 2 form. Okay. So now we can be more specific. Let's try to work this out. So I can think of this as a collection of two rectangles. One is this one, the other one is the top one. Okay. So from this rectangle, the result I of 1 beta minus I of 1. One term. Just this rectangle. Okay, so I am dividing up into two rectangles. This is a z1, z, okay, alpha n. So four corners are alpha, beta, alpha, beta. Now this rectangle. Okay. So along this rectangle, you see z1 is changing from z1 alpha to z1 gamma. So plus plus times z2 is changing from z2 beta to z2 gamma. So xi of z2 gamma. Okay, so this then is what? Sorry, I should have actually put this whole function of just to be here again after we get our xi itself. Okay, so basically you take this combination of the xi's.
Why
aren't
you writing the chi's?
The chi's. Yeah. Because you need, see, you need to integrate over this two dimensional plane, no? So you need the dz1 and dz1 or dz2 term. If I use a chi, then it goes into dz1 and dz2 term left. Yeah, so that's why the chi is gone. Not like that. Okay, this is the usual form. Okay, there are no p. Or the PCO have been completely stripped of any dz's. Okay. This O is the usual thing that comes in a boson exchange. Is this clear? Okay, now 2 points I have to mention here before I go on. First is that once we have specified the q alpha beta, say q alpha beta, that is an amide, right? Because I could have chosen this path or that. But once q alpha beta has been specified, you see that q alpha beta gamma has no further intermediates. Okay, the path is, this surface is completely fixed. It's also easy to verify that there will be no further direction terms that are needed here, because see these, I mean, this looks like 2-dimensional subspace, but these are of course n minus 2-dimensional space, right? These, some of these will intersect over an n minus 3-dimensional space. Right, 2-dimensional 3. So we wonder, do you have to add corrections from there? Okay. And with a little thought, you can convince yourself that no further corrections are necessary. Okay, and that has to do with the fact that these q alpha beta gammas are unique. Okay, so they will simply match up and fill the region. You don't get any further correction. Okay, you can also see why. Right? You can imagine that we have some correction terms on a codimension 3 subspace, right, of MGM. Right? Suppose these things meet on a codimension 3 subspace. Right? That's an M minus 3 dimensional space. Right? So if there is a hole to be left over on that, in the fiber direction it should be a 3 dimensional hole. Because total dimension of space is L. Right? So if it's on an M minus 3 dimensional subspace, then there should be a 3 dimensional hole in the fiber. But fiber is only 2 dimensional. Right? Fiber is being spanned by Z1 and Z2. Right? The local coordinates are not relevant, right? They are not changing. So it's impossible to get a 3-dimensional hole when you have only 2 fiber coordinates. So you can stop basically at k, codimension k. You have to go up to codimension k, but after that you don't have to go in. Okay, if there are k principles. K. Right? K is 2 here. That's why you stop at codimension.
This calculation in PGM and we first make the choice of section and do our by good force, we just do this over our 6 years.
Exactly.
Then all these terms should come back.
Exactly. I mean, after all, where did you get this from, right? Because you are integrating omega n over this whole thing, right? This subspace and this in the fiber direction. Right? All you are saying is that this is singular because spurious poles are passing all around, all through this, right? But once you have integrated and written it as an integral in MGMM, okay, then you don't see any spurious poles anywhere, right? Because this depends only on the endpoints manifestly. Right? There is no integral in water. Okay, that's why it's easier to, I mean, it's more rigorous to think of this as integrals for MGMM. Although, for intuitively to see what is happening, okay, it's useful to think in terms of PGMM. Okay, basically, what you are doing is that you are filling up all the holes in PGMM so that the subspace on which you are integrating is a continuous subspace. Okay, that's the key point, that you have to integrate over a continuous subspace of PGMM. And hence, you have to make sure that all the holes are filled. Okay, now suppose K is 3.
This kind of difference that you had calculated in the last lecture and you have added it here.
Exactly. So it's the whole thing done one dimension less, and that has to do with the fact that what I was doing in the last lecture and what I am doing in this lecture is slightly different. In the last lecture, I was taking two different sections and trying to calculate the difference. Right? That was integrated, that was d omega over one higher dimensional subspace. Right? But otherwise, you are right. That it's basically the same identity that I have used here. Right? Here, all you are saying is that you have to fill the section, make sure that it's a continuous section, and that's what. And it's a mismatch. See, in the last lecture, you are considering that even on the same M alpha beta, in the last lecture, the same M alpha beta, there are two different choices, okay, and they could differ, right? And their difference is again a two-dimensional subspace, and we have to show that difference will be given by integral over those. Here the goal is slightly different, but the analysis is related, right? I mean, because it's exactly the difference is again you integrate over this subspace and project it down the edge.
Can you explain how you chose those paths in this
path? This path?
Yeah,
so this is a convention that on each M alpha beta, right? You have to make a convention of how you go move from in what order you move the PCOs. Right? That's part of the data that we use for building a section. Right? So I have chosen the path so that you first move one, then two. So that's why this path I took one moves first, then two. Right? Then in going from here to here, again one moves first, then two. Okay? And in going from here to here, one moves first, then two. Okay? This is a convention. Okay, I could have taken, for example, that here one moves first, then two, one moves first, then two, and here two moves first, then one. Okay? Then what will happen? Then you will go like this. Okay? Then the path that is left over, okay, you can figure out. I mean, it's still a closed path after all, right? Okay? So this is will be the region that is left over. Okay. So this subspace depends on the choice of M alpha metals. Right? What you have to the correction term that you have to add, right? That not the M alpha with Q alpha metals. Okay, what path you have chosen to describe the vertical jump. Mm-hmm. But once Q alpha metals are given, then there is no further ambiguity in choosing this. Right? It's either this or as I said, if it's one first 2 second, one first 2 second, and then two first 1 second, then is this region of origin. Is this clear?
So and these paths will be determined by how the locus of the poles cut these. Right? I mean we don't want this the locus to cut and go out.
No, it can cut and go out. As long as the endpoints are free from spurious singularity. Okay? It doesn't really matter what happens to the locus of the. You have to make sure that the endpoints have no spurious singularity, because final results are all given by the psi is inserted at these vertices. Okay, if you look at the expression, so all you have to make sure is that the vertices, you have chosen your PCO in such a way that the vertices are free from spurious singularity. Okay, that has spurious singularity on these links, so it's inside the face, it doesn't matter. Is this clear? Because ultimately when you write it down to MGMM, right? All that is involved that in the integrand and MGMM involved, so the vortices.
Yes, sir. So for calculating conical amplitudes, so the best way to choose the path so that these holes are not there. So you choose the
but, path. No, you cannot do that. See, you see, the point is, suppose you have chosen this, right? When you go from 3 to 1, it's impossible because 3 to 1 doesn't know about 2, right? Because 3 to 1 you have to specify in general here, right? It doesn't know about the existence of this beta, right? So, when you go from here to here, there is no choice of that you go like this, right? Because this point has no meaning when you specify how to move from gamma to alpha. You can do this or you can do this, but you cannot go back like this. Yes, because what is happening here is that, I mean, here you have in gamma to alpha, here you have given specified a choice of z1z, and here you have given a choice of z1z, right? And you have to specify once and for all on this boundary how you move from z1z to z1z, right? So you either move z1 first then z2 or z2 first then z1.
You can take halfway, I mean this.
But see, z beta is already defined here.
No, what is the numerical value of z beta 1, z beta 2?
But the point, these are different regions to modulize this. So it doesn't make sense to take a z beta from here and lift it here. No, it says that the notion of z beta is tied to a moduli space, a point in the moduli space, right? If you are taking two different points in the moduli space, it doesn't make sense to say that you go from z alpha to z beta and then to z gamma. Because that z beta was defined in this region of the moduli space, right? See, on this boundary it makes sense to talk about z beta because this boundary is a common boundary between these two. But on this boundary, the z beta has no meaning.
So we approach the junction to these three lines, and for each line, I mean, my.
You specify independently how to move, right? On each line, you specify the move based on the data that exists on two sides of the line. Right? That here it exists z1 gamma, z2 gamma, this here it exists z1 alpha, z2 alpha. Okay? You can specify the z1 alpha, z2 alpha moves to. Z1 gamma z2 gamma moves to z1 alpha z2 alpha along certain paths. Okay, but those paths will have to be specified only in terms of z1 alpha z2 alpha and z1 gamma z2 gamma. Okay. The beta has no meaning in that on that boundary.
That's because it's also this vertical thing which you're.
Exactly. Yeah. For example, there are, I'm a junction like this, right? So which beta do you use? This beta or this beta? Yeah, so there is no invariant meeting, meaning so this may be delta, right? There is a similar problem here. So there is no, so this you cannot avoid even for initial amplitudes, right? You have to add these connections on this co-dimensional two subspaces. Right? The best you can hope for is that the number of such regions that you have to use on MGM is small, right? So that there are not too many junctions like this. For example, if you could do it by just breaking up MGM into two regions, right? You specify the PCO in the first region and the second region. Then of course there is no triple junction like this, right? Then this problem doesn't exist. But in general, okay, on sufficiently high in the surface, I mean, there doesn't seem to be any other way. In general, you have to add corrections of this kind, right, on this code dimension surfaces.
So, everything like this, that for each pair of these sections, I have the freedom to choose a path from going from one to other.
Yes.
Once I join all the sections, on all the sections, there should be something which restricts my choice that I have to have a.
No, so you are not restricting these paths, we are just adding something.
Yes, exactly.
So you cannot restrict these paths, right? Because what you specify as a jump here, right? It doesn't know, it's a local, it should be depend on local data,
right?
Exactly. So whatever is missing, you add, right? You see that you join these subspaces, you find that after you have joined the subspaces, right, it's like if you have a subspace in two dimensions, right? Suppose you take a subspace like this, then you take another subspace like this, and finally take another subspace like this, right? And you find that you have covered this region, this region, this region, this region, but this is not covered by your procedure, right? Then this subspace you have to add back, right? Separately, right? Integral over this region. That's what you are doing. So what is happening here is if you just do what I did earlier, right, by these particular sections, there's a gap that is left over, which you have to add. Right? You have to add the integral over the gap. Is this clear? Okay, now let's see what happens for k equal to 3. So for k equal to 3, you have a cube. In fact, you should draw another cube because this is alpha, this is beta, and then one more gamma. Right? Think of this as a double cube. But maybe I can, let's see if I can do it here. It's going to be messy. You have a fan lamp to do that. You can imagine, right? So basically, you have a cube of length 2. Okay, and you have to divide it into 8 sets, right? If you have cube of length 2, length 2, then that cube can be divided into 8 cells each unit cell. Now, you go from alpha to beta along some path, right? And that path has a structure that it's made of the lengths. Okay, so take this. This one, this one, this. This one, this one. So this means 1 moves first, 3 moves next, 2 moves last. Then between beta and gamma, you have a similar path. And then again between gamma and alpha, you have a path. Yeah, that's going to be on the bigger curve. Along the links of the bigger curve. Now, here it may look like that we are thinking of alpha, beta and gamma as order, right? Beta is somehow in between alpha and gamma. But that's actually there. Right. I mean, you could have put this as gamma and this as beta, topologically it makes no difference. Okay, this is like that. So how you order alpha, beta, gamma is not relevant. Okay, but anyway, so alpha, beta and gamma, so gamma comes back to alpha. Okay. So what you have is still a closed path. Right? Because you go from alpha and end up at alpha, right? Alpha to beta, beta to gamma, and gamma back to alpha. Right? So that means in terms of this cube, you go from 0, 0, 0 to 1, 1, 1, then 1, 1, 1 to 2, 2, 2, and then from 2 to 2, you come back to 0, 0, 0. That's a closed path. So given that it's a closed path, there is a subspace, there is a surface that is enclosed by the closed path. Right? Many surfaces. But we don't want arbitrary surfaces. Yeah? These surfaces will have to have a specific property if we want to use a rule of particle integration. So what should the subspace, what property should the subspace have? So this two-dimensional surface that is bounded by this curve has to be thought of as a collection of faces, which means a collection of two-dimensional subspaces such that on each subspace only two of the coordinates are. Is that clear? Why do we need that? Just like for integrating over one dimensional subspace, right? You need that only one coordinate by each time. Right? So if you have two such coordinates, if on a certain surface, only two coordinates vary at a time, then you can do this integral, right? Integral delta z1 dz1 with delta I z to d z 2. And this is given by as defined by the coordinate, exactly as we had here. But if you have a more general two dimensional surface, then you cannot apply the rule of particle integration. Okay, it's not expressive in terms of only the coordinates. So this is what we need, then. Okay, that this closed loop that you have about, we have to think of this as a boundary of a two-dimensional subspace, three-dimensional space, and that two-dimensional subspace has to be built out of phases, which means the built out of subspaces which on which the each segment has a property that only two coordinates are identified. Now you can easily convince yourself that indeed there are such subspaces. Yeah, you basically have to take arbitrary closed subspace and try to smooth it, deform it so that it lies along the faces. Right? And it will become a collection of faces. Okay, so finding such a collection of two-dimensional subspaces, okay, is not difficult. Given any closed curve like this, okay, you can always go to the collection of two-dimensional subspaces on such that on each subspace only two coordinates. Right? The problem is that this subspace is not unique. Okay? Just like this was not unique. Okay, that given this curve and this curve, okay, there are two different possible choices. Okay, that was the two different possible choices for Q alpha beta. Now you will find Q alpha beta gamma, okay, which is this two-dimensional subspace, is no longer unique. This is point here. Okay. So Q alpha beta gamma is a collection of phases. Okay. So phase by definition is one on each only two coordinates are identified. Okay. So the collection of phases such that the boundary of Q alpha beta gamma, that means probably minus sign. Q alpha beta minus Q beta gamma minus Q gamma alpha. Okay, so this basically means that you take a collection of these curves, Q alpha beta is going from alpha to beta, then Q beta gamma is going from beta to gamma, Q gamma alpha is going from gamma to alpha, and you look for a Q alpha beta gamma whose boundary is this. Okay, and that Q alpha beta gamma has to be a collection of phases. It's certainly possible to find Q alpha beta satisfying this, but this Q alpha beta gamma is not unique. So just like in the choice of Q alpha beta, there is an ambiguity and you have to fix a choice. Now you have to fix a choice. Okay, this choice basically means that how you fill the hole. Okay, how you fill the hole, here it has unique possibility. Now there are different possibilities of filling the hole. Okay, just like earlier, to fill the gap, okay, this one-dimensional hole. Okay, there are different possibilities which depend, which was encoded in how you move, in which order you move the pieces, right? The sum, it's the sum of links, the endpoints are fixed. But what links you choose is up to you. Okay? Here, what faces you choose is up to you. Okay, it's not completely arbitrary because the boundary is fixed, but there is a lot of ambiguity. So you have to make a choice. So make a choice. And now you will find that once you have made this choice, now when these meet this point, it's a codimension 2 subspaces, right? When this codimension 2 subspaces now meet on a codimension 3 subspace, you have to add collection terms. The holes do not, there is still a hole left over. Okay? These regions do not quite match up. And this is essentially reflected in the fact that Q alpha beta gamma is not unique. Different roles of choosing Q alpha beta gamma will give different roles that you have to fill. But for k equal to 3, it stops there. you will get, basically, so the whole dynamic field is now in here, it has a 2-dimensional surface. Now it will be a 3-dimensional cubic volume. Okay, 3-dimensional volume over a 4-dimensional 3 subspace. Right? So again, the total dimension adds up to n. Okay, take an n minus 3-dimensional subspace on MGMN. Okay? And now the fiber direction, the amount of the dimension of the region that have to fill in the fiber direction is 3-dimensional.
Is always less than the dimension of
MGMN? No. Well, typically yes. Typically K is always less than the dimension of MGMN because K is 2G minus 2. Okay. Dimension of MGMN is 6G minus 6 plus 2M plus 2N. But if you could imagine a situation where K is more, right, then of course you will stop when you reach 0 dimensional subspace, right?
But then
you
jump to
some
ambiguity left.
No, there will be no ambiguity left. But k is always less than the dimension of it, MGM, right? So basically k is a deciding factor when you have to stop. Then you have to go up to co-dimension k, okay, and then you stop.
Like here in that picture, suppose the dimension of the model m was just 2, and
yes,
suppose k was 3.
Yes. So then you will find that there is also gap there. Then it doesn't intersect anywhere, no? I mean, solid is 0 dimensional, right? So the kind of problem that you might anticipate that when these things meet, that there is a hole left over, these things never meet. See, this was a 2 dimensional, MGMN was 2 dimensional, right? Then you have made sure that on these, the gap is filled, right? Now the problem was that if these things meet somewhere,
yes,
right, then there will be a gap left over. But if it's 2-dimensional, then these things will not meet anywhere.
That is true, but how I fill the gap, that would not be unique if k was
equal to. Yes, that is true. That will not be unique. But that's not a problem.
It's not a problem.
Because it's just different choice of sections. Right? And you have to analyze this by using Stokes' theorem. Right? For on-shell steps, it will give total derivative. Well, for on-shell steps, it will be valid because qb acting on a is 0. Right? So it's the same argument that we use for proving the identities out here, right? The two different choice of section. Okay. Why do you give the same answer? Yeah, so it's the same argument that you have to apply. So once you think in terms of PGMN, right? Or even though PGMN is only intuitive, not a rigorous definition, because you are passing the surfaces to spurious holes. Once you think in terms of PGMN, then it becomes clear when what the ambiguities are, okay, and what you have to do to resolve them. And then to make this into a rigorous statement, you can come down to MGMN, where everything is well defined, and translate whatever you derived in PGMN in terms of MGMN. Okay? So this is the reason why thinking of PGMN is a useful concept, even though it is not completely well defined because you are passing the surfaces through spurious right? And you have to make a prescription of how to make it, okay, which is using this particle integration.
The number of issues that we have to
insert
in a correlation function
is fixed.
Yeah,
it's
fixed by
m and 2g
minus
2. Exactly, that's right. So the one that's always less than the dimension of the one is fixed. Because it's 2g minus 2, right, plus
for
m plus n.
So if I increase one, other will.
Exactly. Right? So if we add a new function, say ns function, the number of issues increases by 1, right, whereas the number of modula increases by 2. Okay, so maybe so this is a general idea. So maybe tomorrow I'll just give a complete prescription based on this general idea. But I think once the general idea is clear, it should be also clear what one has to do. Right? Basically, one has to continue this till one kills all the gaps.